Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Devouring by James R. Benn. Narrated by Peter Berkrot. In Memory of Ranger, 2002 to 2016. Faithful Companion, by my side for 12 Billy Boyle novels. When gold speaks, every tongue is silent. Italian proverb. Chapter 1. Light is faster than sound. Strange, the things you think about when you're about to die. Even as traces lit the night air, their silent, silvery phosphorescence clawing at our small aircraft from the ground below, a tiny part of my brain mused on this practical demonstration of that scientific fact. The rest of my brain panicked madly, sending surges of adrenaline coursing through my body, urging me to get the hell out, now. Which was not at all helpful, given that we were flying at 500 feet, heading directly into heavy anti-aircraft fire, making 180 miles per hour. Then came the sound, the chattering of ack-ack fire, flak exploding in blinding flashes all around us. Shrapnel struck the aircraft, rending the metal, sounding like the devil's own hailstorm on a sheet metal roof. "Hold tight!" shouted the pilot, as he dove the Lysander and put it through twists and turns to evade the lead rising up against us. I looked below as he dipped the airplane and saw the twinkling of automatic fire from along the stretch of river we'd been following. "They're on the road!" I shouted to the pilot in the single front seat. It was a column of German vehicles, moving at night to avoid Allied aircraft, and we'd flown dead at them. The pilot didn't waste breath answering. He banked left, violently, diving to treetop level at a right angle away from the river. Looking back, I saw tracer fire searching vainly for us, then fade as the Krauts gave up and continued on their way. The Lysander jolted, loud thumps whacking against the aircraft frame. "Sorry, chaps," the pilot muttered, pulling back on the yoke and gaining altitude. "Almost landed in the pines. She's a bit sluggish. Might have caught some shrapnel in the rudder." He banked the Lysander, bringing us around to the river again, the only map to our destination. "There may be other columns on the road," Kaz said, adjusting his steel-rimmed spectacles. Even after nearly being blown out of the sky and tossed around inside the cramped Lysander, he managed to sound nonchalant, his precise English leavened with the slightest of Polish accents. "The Somme River is our only landmark," the pilot said, "Jerry's travel plans notwithstanding. If we veer off to the east, we run the risk of entering Swiss airspace. It'd be damned embarrassing to be shot down by the Swiss after all." "Why?" Kaz asked. "You know the Swiss. Chocolate, watches and sheep. That's what they're famous for. I'd never hear the end of it, if I lived to tell the tale. Personally, I'd choose death by chocolatier if I had any say in the matter," Kaz responded. Switzerland was our ultimate destination, and we weren't in the market for wristwatches. "Don't worry about the Swiss or the Jerrys," the pilot said. "I haven't lost a Joe yet, and I don't plan on starting tonight." We were his Joes. It was what special operations executive pilots called the agents and commandos they flew into occupied Europe. No names, nothing to reveal if captured and tortured. Just an anonymous one-way ride to some grassy field in the countryside. In a few minutes we were back on course, flying low over dark hills and a glistening waterway, the bright half-moon at our backs providing a tempting target for alert Kraut gunners, the river our only guide. "What's the next landmark?" I asked the nameless pilot. "We'll bear left at the Rhone River in Lyon. There's a sharp bend in the river. It'll be easy to spot, even with only a half moon. Then Lake Gris, a narrow lake about 12 miles long. I set us down outside of Sesson in a nice open field on a ridge overlooking the water. A bit tricky, but very secluded." Tricky I didn't mind, if it meant no Krauts. We flew on, no sign of movement below us. Not a single light visible in the blacked-out countryside. The drone of the engine was mesmerizing, lulling us into a sense of security and safety. The sudden, surprising, bright barrage of fire now behind us. The high, clear canopy gave us a majestic view of the sparkling heavens. The half-moon, the stars, and the faint glow from the instrument panel, our only illuminations, guiding us as we traveled across a calm sea of inky black. I almost relaxed. "What is that?" Kaz asked, leaning forward and pointing at 2 o'clock. Searchlights flickered in the distance, an orange glow growing at the horizon. "Bloody bomber command, most likely," the pilot answered in a low growl. "Hitting the rail yards in Lyon, or the airfield west of the city. Either way, they've stirred up a hornet's nest for us." "Can we go around it?" I asked. "No," he said. "I don't have the fuel. We're at the extreme range as it is. I topped off at a forward airstrip in Normandy, but I've barely enough to make it back." "We must fly through that?" Kaz asked. As we drew closer, the night sky grew brighter with searchlights, explosions, and burning buildings. "Unless you Joes want to abort the mission, say the word and I'll turn around." "Have you ever had to abort?" I asked. "No, thought I'd offer, that's all," he said, turning to smile at us. SOE pilot humor, I guess. "It's not as bad as it looks, mates. We're under their radar, and the Jerrys are looking for high-altitude bombers, not our little Lysander." "Don't fly under the bomber formation," Kaz said. "Being hit by an RAF bomb would be more embarrassing than being shot down by the Swiss." "Right you are," the pilot said. "Now all we need to do is catch a glimpse of the Rhone River. It'll be even easier with the sky all lit up. Jerry's doing us a favor." That was one way of looking at it. We drew closer to the city, the searchlights casting wide beams of white light, looking like columns holding up the night sky. Phosphorescent tracer bullets sought out the bombers, dancing against the darkness in graceful, deadly arcs. Bombs exploded in front of us, maybe a quarter of a mile away. The pilot banked the Lysander, moving away from the flames and smoke. The aircraft shook as shock waves from the explosions buffeted us, sending the plane into a sideways dive. The ground looked damn close. "Hang on," the pilot told us, as if we hadn't already figured that one out. He pulled the small craft up, his voice a nervous quiver he couldn't quite hide. "That's the main rail yard. We should be fine now. Look, there's the river." It was the Rhone, leading west from the burning city, shimmering with moonlight and mayhem, anti-aircraft fire dying down as the bomber stream departed. "Is the plane damaged?" Kaz asked. There was a metallic rattle coming from the fuselage. "She's banged up," the pilot said. "But I can hold her steady, don't worry. The good news is, I can cut some time off our trip and make sure you chaps get to Saison. The Rhone meanders a good bit, so I'll cut across the bends heading 90 degrees west. That'll bring us to Lake Gris all the quicker." "What's the bad news?" I asked. "It will bring us closer to a Luftwaffe airfield. Sounds worse than it is, really. Any night fighters they have left will be airborne, going after the bombers. We'll scoot right by. You should be on the ground in 30 minutes. "So the airfield poses no danger?" Kaz asked, his tone skeptical.
"Right. Long as one of the flak batteries doesn't open up on us. So, once again, hang on."
He increased speed and lost altitude, skimming the treetops until we found ourselves over open fields. It felt as if he were going in for a landing at 200 miles an hour. The rattle clanged even faster, the fuselage shuddering as we raced for the next bend in the river.
"Airfield coming up on the right," the pilot informed us through clenched teeth as he held the yoke firmly in his hands. "There," Kaz said, pointing to black shapes that were probably hangars.
The landscape zipped by underneath us, and we were nearly clear, about to leave the blacked-out airfield behind. Then the sky lit up. Searchlights, some only a few hundred yards away. Bright explosions ripped into the blackness ahead, followed by a series of blasts falling across our path. I lifted my hands to shield my eyes as one of the beams caught us, sending blinding white light into the canopy. More explosions sounded as the pilot climbed,
seeking to escape the clutches of the searchlight and the anti-aircraft fire it would soon bring to bear. Concussions from the bombs hit us, shaking the Lysander, dragging it through the sky as if it were a kite on a string. We'd guessed wrong. The bombers were targeting both the rail yards and the airfield. We'd flown straight into the second raid. The light found us again, staying with the Lysander even as the pilot gave up on altitude and put the nose down, hoping to shake the flak. Tracers burned the night sky, hitting us in the wing, shearing metal, and sending us into a spin. The searchlight lost us. I grabbed onto my seat in Kaz's arm, hoping the pilot could steady the aircraft. I braced for impact. It didn't come. The sturdy Lysander managed to fly straight. So low, we could have been hit by a well-thrown stone. I craned my neck to see behind us, the orange glow of flames and the white searchlights fading in the distance. Wind whistled through a bullet hole in the canopy, the clanging rattle of metal still sounding from within the fuselage. "The aircraft is damaged," Kaz said, as calmly as he might observe that it may well rain.
"She'll get you there, don't you worry,"
the pilot said, although getting me back home is another thing altogether. "You are welcome to join us if you wish," Kaz said.
"Not in the cards, Joe. The Germans would love to get their hands on a Lysander. I'll stay with the plane until you're safely away and then put the torch to her. Maybe I'll get lucky and spend the rest of the war learning French from a farmer's daughter, if Jerry doesn't catch me."
"Sorry," I said. I felt bad for him, but at the same time I was glad he didn't take Kaz up on the invite. Things would be tough enough without an extra man along. If he was lucky, our resistance contacts would leave somebody with him. But we had places to go, and fast.
"C'est la guerre," he answered, the yoke vibrating violently in his hands. A harsh knock came from the engine, followed by a metal-on-metal grating.
The propeller stopped. Oil sprayed the windscreen.
"Oh, shit," the pilot said.
The Lysander dropped from the sky. Chapter 2.
"Billy, wake up!"
I felt someone push me. It was Kaz, bracing himself against my shoulder and grunting in between shouts for me to wake up. I tried to clear my head, but it hurt like blazes. I wanted nothing more than for him to shut up and get off me so I could go back to sleep. Then I began to choke. That got my attention. I tried to focus, wiping my eyes with the back of my hand. It came away wet and sticky with blood. Kaz was kicking at the canopy, using me to steady himself as he hammered away at the latch.
"It's stuck," he announced.
"Obviously, since otherwise, why would we be inside a crashed aircraft filling with smoke?"
"Let me,"
I said, twisting around in the seat to bring my legs up. I smashed both feet against the twisted metal frame, once, twice, and then again. The latch broke as I gasped for air, and Kaz shoved the shattered canopy back. The air drew smoke like a chimney, and my gasps turned to ragged coughs.
"The pilot," I managed to croak.
"Dead," was all Kaz said, as he clambered down the ladder on the side of the fuselage.
"Hurry!"
I leaned forward as I made for the opening. The pilot was slumped over the yoke, his bloodied head at a terribly wrong angle. Sparks flashed on his instrument panel, followed by the soft sound of gas fumes igniting. Flames drove me back, licking at my limbs as I made for the open canopy and jumped to the ground. I rolled into Kaz's arms and he dragged me away as fire spread from the engine, half buried in the damp ground. It filled the rear compartment, roaring and swirling within the perspex enclosure, the blaze an angry crimson column as it raced out the opening and into the air. Then the fuel tank went up, a bright, searing fireball lifting the Lysander and slamming it back into the earth in a flurry of broken metal and black smoke. The heat scorched our faces as we scrambled backward, arms linked and eyes fixed on the conflagration.
"Are you badly injured?" Kaz asked. "I didn't know."
"I don't think so," I said, feeling my forehead. I winced as I found a gash on my scalp, hair matted in sticky blood.
"We have to move."
"Right. We are not far beyond the airfield. This fire will be visible for miles, and the Germans are sure to investigate.
Kaz helped me up, his eyes darting to the horizon. We were in the middle of a field, lush green grass that might have made good grazing for some farmer's herd of sheep. Our pilot picked the crash site well, if he'd had any say in the matter.
Which way? I asked.
Kaz took a compass from his pocket and waited for the luminous hand to steady. The burning wreckage cast a flickering light against his face, the steel-rimmed glasses reflecting a shimmering yellow glow. His high cheekbones were marred on one side by a scar that split his face from eye to chin. The other side was darkness, much like Kaz himself.
East is that way,
he said, snapping the compass shut and nodding toward the forested hillside ahead. I brushed the dirt from my trousers and adjusted the strap of the small rucksack across my shoulder. We each had a few supplies. K-rations, maps, matches, a flashlight, and extra cartridges. Not to mention a wad of Swiss francs. We were both armed with a revolver. No real match for a swarm of krauts looking for downed airmen. Then it hit me. The rear canopy was open. They'd know someone made it out, which meant they'd come looking. I stopped, watching the inferno burning itself out. But not fast enough. Kaz caught my eye, nodding his understanding. We searched the ground for a stick or a branch, anything big enough to push the canopy closed without getting too close to the red-hot fuselage. I came up with a tree limb, probably snapped off by the crash. I tried to push against the canopy, but it was the wrong angle. The canopy opened to the rear, sliding on rails. With the aircraft nose down, it was too high to reach, and besides, the branch gave me nothing to grab on with.
I could climb the ladder, Kaz said, as I threw the useless wood aside.
Lysander's had a metal ladder built into the side, to make for quick drop-offs and pickups. From the top, only a few steps up, the canopy would be within easy reach.
The metal on the canopy is too hot, I said, not to mention the ladder itself. How could you grab hold? Give me your overcoat, Kaz said.
We were wearing civilian clothes, and I was taller by almost a head. He was going to use the longer sleeves as gloves.
You sure? I asked as I shed my wool overcoat. It's better than being chased by the Germans, he said.
He put my coat on over his, giving him more protection from the heat. I emptied my rucksack, putting the strap across his shoulder.
Use this to snag the handle and pull it shut, I said.
He tucked his hands as far inside the sleeves as they'd go and reached for the rung. The flames weren't as ferocious as before, but the fuel was still burning off. The stench of roasted flesh assailed us, and for a second we both staggered back. I cupped my hands to give Kaz a boost. With one hand on my shoulder, the other grasping hot metal, he started up. I prayed the thick wool would protect him. Two steps and he was close to the canopy. Still holding on with one hand, he leaned back and tossed the strap at the handle, tantalizingly close. He missed. Another toss, another miss. I checked the horizon in the direction of the airfield. Maybe they weren't coming. Kaz made another throw, this time hitting the mark. He let go of the ladder, pulling on the rucksack with both hands. He grunted, leaning away from the fuselage. He yelled, cursing in Polish as he pulled as hard as he could. The canopy slid forward. Kaz tumbled from the ladder, falling onto me. We both hit the ground hard.
Are you okay? I asked, checking his hand.
The fabric was smoking.
Yes, I think so.
He shook his hand and winced.
A small burn, perhaps, but nothing too bad.
I could see a red line in his palm by the light of the fire. Another few seconds and it would have been much worse.
But we must take care of that, he said, pointing to the canopy.
The rucksack hung from the exterior handle. I looked around for the branch, which would now come in handy. As I did, I saw a faint light in the distance, moving, bouncing as if going over a country road.
Germans,
I whispered, even though I could have shouted without my voice carrying far enough to worry. On the run in civilian clothes behind enemy lines had that kind of effect. I grabbed the rucksack and gathered up the contents I'd emptied from it. The headlights were closer now, coming cross-country and making for the burning wreckage. Kaz tossed me my coat and we hightailed it out of there, due east, up a gently rising knoll, until we were safely under cover in the pines. "Give me a hand," I said, opening the first aid kit. I squeezed burn ointment into his palm and wrapped it with gauze. Kaz whispered his thanks as we peered into the night, watching two trucks park near the Lysander, headlights illuminating the ground around it. Germans swarmed about the aircraft, dark smoke billowing from the engine as the fire lessened. I could make out shouted orders and saw soldiers fanning out in a methodical search. Nothing unusual about that. If they thought this was a planned landing gone bad, there might be members of the resistance nearby. Not that any sane SOE pilot would voluntarily set down a few miles from a Luftwaffe airfield.
"We should go," Kaz said.
"Right," I said, stuffing the medical kit back into my rucksack. I rummaged through the contents, looking for the map, hoping it included our current area. It wasn't there.
"Damn," I said with a hiss. "The map's gone. I thought I put it back."
"They might not find it," Kaz said, "or they may think it came from the aircraft. The front canopy was fairly smashed." A dog barked, sharp, mad dog growls.
"If he has a scent from the map," I said.
"Run," Kaz said, grabbing me by the shoulder. I followed, working to keep Kaz in sight. Moonlight was sparse within the pine forest, the sound of Kaz's feet on the soft ground my best guide. We both took a few tumbles, tripping on roots and rocks invisible in the gloomy dark. Soon the land began to slope downward, and we sped up, sliding and careening through stands of dead pine. Many of the trees snapped in a windstorm like matchsticks.
"Careful,"
I panted, catching up to Kaz. "We don't need a broken leg."
"That would be inconvenient," he said, gasping for breath. "As would be a German shepherd at my throat."
We took a quick rest, heaving in the crisp night air, listening for sounds of the chase. Barks echoed against the hillside, a dog excited at the prospect of a moonlight hunt.
"How fast can a dog run?" Kaz asked.
"Plenty fast," I said, "but his handler won't let him run free. He'll keep a tight leash until he has us in sight."
"And then?"
"And then they shoot us, or unleash the dog. Unless we give up, and then they shoot us later."
"The prospects are quite limited, Billy. Is there anything we can do?"
"Keep running, for one. There's a chance that dog is a plain old guard dog. He'd be dangerous if he saw us, but if he's not trained to follow a scent, all we need to do is stay ahead of him."
"Let's go," Kaz said.
"Since we have no way of knowing, we should assume he is tracking us. Although it is your scent on the map, Billy." Before I had a chance at a wiseacre comeback, the barking started up again. Too close for comfort, tracker or guard dog. I wet my finger and held it up. The wind was coming from the east, the direction we were headed.
"We could start a fire," I said. "It's the only thing that could throw him off the scent."
"Burn all traces," Kaz said.
"Good.
The smoke will do most of the work. The wind will blow it right in their faces. Gather some wood." We were surrounded by dead and weathered limbs, perfect for starting a forest fire. The trick was to get it going fast. They'd spot the fire in no time, so it had to be a blazing inferno, with thick choking smoke, before they got too close. We stacked small branches against a fallen tree and I lit a match. The wind blew it out. I tried another, shielding it with my body. The flame took, climbing twigs and brush, until it leaped onto larger sticks, the dry pine a tinderbox of roaring, dancing fire in no time. The wind fanned the sparks, sending glowing embers out over the fallen trees. We had our inferno. A rapid pace took us to the crest of the next hill, where we stopped to rest and check on our pursuers. Lines of yellow and red, blurred by whirling smoke, snaked down the slope, obscuring our visions. And theirs. No dog barked. No boots thumped against the ground.
"They've given up," Kaz said.
"Or wised up," I said. "Why fight your way through smoke and fire when there are other Germans to the east?
There have to be patrols along the Swiss border.
We're not close enough for border patrols, Kaz said. I prefer to think they've gone back to their warm beds. No reason for all of us to be miserable out here.
You're a prince, Kaz, I said, slapping him on the shoulder, as we leaned into the wind and continued our eastward journey.
A mere baron, Billy. But thank you.
Chapter 3. The esteemed Baron Pyotr Augustus Casimirs and I huddled in a shepherd's abandoned cottage. At least I hoped it was abandoned, since that would mean no one else had been forced to spend the night in this dump for years. It smelled like a barnyard, and the wind howled through the one window, which held no more than a shard or two of glass. Moldy blankets littered a rough-hewn bed frame. We stretched out on the hard-packed dirt floor, which was the cleanest thing in sight. Kaz, I called him that since his full name was a mouthful, was a lieutenant in the Polish army in exile. He and I worked for General Eisenhower, which probably had a lot to do with why we were here in this ramshackle hut in southeastern France right now. Last night, we'd had a rendezvous with an SOE Lysander. Special Operations Executive, that is. Lysanders are SOE's preferred means to ferry agents in and out of occupied France. We'd expected to be taken back to London after our last assignment, but someone had a better idea. Send the two of us to the Swiss border, smuggle us across, and then have us make contact with the OSS, a different group of highly dangerous letters. The Office of Strategic Services was an American outfit, modeled after the SOE. Why they wanted us in neutral Switzerland, I had no clue. But I did have hopes it would be a rest cure in a peaceful nation. Some wags claimed OSS stood for Oh, So Social, since they drew a lot of personnel from Ivy League schools and the elites of industry, Wall Street, and high-powered law offices. If it meant reservations at a nice hotel, I had no problems with their pedigrees. But we were a long hike from the Swiss border. First, we had to make it to Cezanne and meet our French resistance contact. Then a team of Jedburghs, SOE commando types, would get us across the border, evading both German patrols and Swiss border guards. After that, our orders were to meet with an OSS operative in Geneva, not too far from the border. Easy, right? That's what our pilot said when he briefed us at the pickup. Now he was a charred corpse. It was supposed to have been so easy that we weren't prepared for an overland trek. We were dressed in suits and overcoats, with civilian IDs using our real names. The paperwork showed that we were attached to the American legation as assistant economic attachés, which would hold water for about 10 minutes if anyone questioned us. Travel in or out of Switzerland was limited and strictly regulated. The Swiss government knew exactly how many diplomats were attached to each legation. Right now, I would have happily traded my phony identification for a Thompson submachine gun and a grenade. All we had were the meager supplies in our rucksacks. I was too worried to sleep. Kaz snored softly as I listened to the sounds of the forest, every rustle of leaves and gust of wind making me grip my .38 police special revolver even tighter. Billy. Wake up, Kaz said, his low voice penetrating through the fog of sleep.
Okay, so fatigue had trumped worry.
What?
He pointed in the direction of the broken window. Outside, a man stood cradling a rifle. He was watching us, his face devoid of expression, the rising sun painting the clouds pink at his back.
Bonjour,
Kaz said, smiling as he slowly stood up and pushed open the door. I followed suit, grinning at the prospect of better accommodations. The fella didn't smile back, or do much of anything. He stared at each of us in turn, his rifle held lazily within the crook of his arm. He wore a black beret covering long, dark, curly hair. His corduroy pants were mud-stained, and as dirty as his worn leather jacket and threadbare sweater. His boots, the bayonet in its leather scabbard, and his Kar 98K rifle were all German.
Resistance, I asked. Comment vous appelez-vous?
Kaz said, asking his name. He didn't respond, but moved toward us, taking Kaz's pack and searching through it. He studied the K-ration packet, his brow furrowing as he contemplated the English description. Then he held up the box of bullets, his eyebrows raised. Kaz understood. He slowly lifted his Webley revolver from his coat pocket and then returned it. I did the same with my pistol. Our friend gave a quick nod, the closest we'd come to any kind of communication. Kaz unfolded his map and held it open.
We some new?
Yeah, it would be nice to know where we were. He studied the map, Kaz still gripping it. He smiled and pointed to a spot in the air, about a foot to the left of the sheet.
I guess mine was the one we needed,
I said, as Kaz folded and stowed his map.
Yes, this one shows more of Switzerland,
Kaz said.
Swiss?
He asked, his finger tracing the Swiss border. The swarthy fellow spat, his dark eyes narrowing at the mention of the nation. He crooked his finger and strode off. Kaz offered up a shrug and followed. We didn't have much choice, so why not? Any port in a storm. Any resistance fighter when you're lost in the forest. If that's who he really was. He led us up another steep hill. The terrain was a series of folds in the landscape. A hill, a narrow valley, then an even higher hill. We trudged along, on paths and through meadows ripe with wildflowers. It was mid-June and spring was in full bloom. Scant days ago, men had fought, struggled, and died to assault the beaches in Normandy. It felt strange to be walking amid such beauty, heading to neutral safety, as the battle to liberate France raged a few hundred miles to the north. We neared the top. The trees were thinner here, and we moved with care along a rocky path, hunched over and heads down, watching the terrain ahead for any sign of movement. At the ridgeline, the view was stunning. Below, a wide valley glistened in the sunlight, a broad river cutting through the lush green fields. In the far distance, snow-capped peaks floated in the haze.
Switzerland, Kaz said.
Our guide, or whatever he was, didn't respond.
Cezanne?
I asked, keeping things local. Lake Gris? At the mention of the lake, he faced me, his eyes quiet pools of dark light. He held my gaze for a long time, then glanced at my pack. I got the message. I broke open the K-rations and gave him the can of diced eggs and ham. It went into his pocket, along with the small pack of Chesterfields. He sat, stretching out his legs on a flat rock. I handed around crackers and we all munched in silence, enjoying the view.
American.
His voice was gruff, nearly a growl, as if he didn't use it much. He pointed at me as he picked crumbs from his bushy mustache. I nodded.
Anglais?
He asked Kaz, a sneer on his lips.
Polonais,
Kaz said. That got something close to a smile, Poles obviously being in his favor more than the English.
Cezanne,
he said, pointing with a sweep of his hand to the opposite side of the river, to the southeast. His hand moved to the right, pointing out a high ridge and waving as if jumping over it.
Lacrie.
Is that the Rhone? I asked Kaz.
Yes. It's the last bend in the river before Cezanne. It looks much wider than it did from the air, doesn't it?
Yeah. How do you say boat in French?
Bateau. Avez-vous un bateau?
Kaz leaned over to look the fellow in the eyes. He shrugged.
Maybe he knew where we could find the boat, or maybe he was bored. Comment vous appelez-vous?
Kaz said, trying again. Yeah, my name's Billy. What's yours? This attempt didn't even warrant a shrug. Ignoring our questions, he rose and began walking down the slope. With no better choice, we followed. Below us, a road paralleled the river. We were more furtive heading down, darting from the cover of trees and hiding behind boulders until we were sure the coast was clear. There wasn't much in the way of traffic, nothing but a few bicyclists and a farmer on a horse-drawn cart. Still, it didn't pay to take chances.
any of the innocent-looking French travelers could be an informer. We halted in a grove of saplings, the last cover before open fields and the road ahead. With a finger to his lips, he gestured for us to be quiet as he peered out from behind the trees. Then, apparently satisfied with the silence, he beckoned us to follow. He sprinted across the field to the road, diving into a ditch on the opposite side. Thick grasses provided decent cover as we lay prone, waiting for who knows what. He waved behind us, his hand forming a pistol. Then he aimed his rifle through the grass, right at a bend in the road.
"He wants us to watch the rear," I said, drawing my pistol. "What the hell is he up to?"
"He appears to be waiting for someone," Kaz said, his voice a whisper. "It seems he was not guiding us anywhere. He was simply heading here for this ambush."
"Why the hell won't he talk?" I said.
Kaz gave me the finger to the lips treatment, which was good advice in the ambush business, I had to admit.
We waited, scrunched down in the tall grass, the river on one side, an open field on the other, in the care of an unknown rifleman waiting to fix someone in his sights. We heard the motor, a deep-throated growl echoing off the hills. No, it was two engines, two distinct sounds. After checking the other direction, it was clear. I watched for the vehicles to round the bend. First came a motorcycle with a sidecar. The passenger held a Schmeisser submachine gun. Then a staff car followed about 30 yards behind. That had to be the target. One rifle against two krauts on the motorcycle, a driver, and maybe one or two officers in the car. Not the best odds, even with the two of us and our pea shooters to watch his back. The motorcycle grew closer. A sharp crack sounded as he fired, metal flying from the hood of the car. He worked the bolt and fired again. The motorcycle wobbled, swerved and crashed, the driver having taken a hit from his second shot. A third shot, and the windshield on the staff car shattered. Steam gushed from the radiator, where his first bullet had been aimed to disable the vehicle. He fired a fourth round on general principle and stood, watching, as the staff car slowed and veered off the road, coming to rest in the ditch. We followed, stealing glances to our rear as we approached the motorcycle. The crowd in the sidecar struggled to get out, his Schmeisser still slung around his neck. Kaz put a bullet between his eyes. I glanced at the other German, who'd been thrown from the motorcycle. His chest was a red blossom where the bullet smashed through his sternum. The staff car was tilted to the side, the doors on the right jammed against the ditch. The driver was dead, having taken a shot to the face. One officer stumbled out, fumbling with the pistol in his holster, a dazed look on his face. Our companion brought the Kraut to his knees with a rifle butt to the head. His captive was a major in the SS. He wore the runic symbols on the lapel of his gray uniform and the death's head insignia on his service cap, which lay on the road in front of him, an unspoken accusation. Quite a prize this major was. Red oozed from a cut on his temple, and he moaned as his hand came away thick with his own blood. He looked at us, his eyes wide in a silent plea for mercy. Much the same look as his captives must have given him when the tables had been turned. Our man grabbed the Kraut from the back by his hair and drew his bayonet. Its sharpened edge shone bright in the morning light. He looked at the blade, admiring it, then to us.
"You wish to know my name? It is Anton Lasho, and I kill every German I see."
He twisted the handful of hair and pulled the SS Major's head, laying the blade against his skin. He whispered in the German's ear as he drew the blade across his throat. He stepped back, watching blood spurt and gush as the Major grasped his neck, fingers clutching the gaping wound in a futile attempt to stem the bubbling flow. Chapter 4. Lasho dragged the four bodies into the middle of the road. He beamed when he saw how Kaz had drilled the motorcyclist, gracing Kaz with a maniacal grin.
"Paul knows what to do with Germans, yes? Kill them," he said, "like the swine they are."
I have ample reason not to disagree, Kaz said, his eyes downcast. He sure did. A whole family of reasons. I wasn't about to take Lasho to task for executing an SS officer, but it did make me wonder how unhinged he might be.
There,
Lasho said, admiring the arrangement of the bodies. He tossed the major's cap onto the toe of his boot, where it hung at a jaunty angle.
For all to see. Now come.
Listen, I said, as he walked down the road. It's time for some answers.
There are no answers, he said.
What the hell does that mean? I said to Kaz as we hurried to catch up.
He owes us an explanation, at least.
I think our friend Anton is speaking at the metaphysical level, Kaz said.
Yeah, that's where the major is, right?
Your grasp of philosophy is matchless, Billy, he said, as we watched Lasho veer off the road and into the thick grasses along the riverbank.
Bateau,
he yelled, waving us over to where he stood, chest high in reeds. We ran through the muck and ooze, soaking our feet, and helped Lasho pull a small rowboat out from its hiding place. By the looks of the peeling paint, it could have been abandoned and left out in the weather for years. But there was caulking along the seams, and she looked like she might do well in a calm pond. The river was maybe 300 or so yards across, with a swift current. Given that the alternative was waiting for a pack of vengeful Germans to round the bend, I helped push as Lasho took up position at the oars. Kaz and I clambered in as soon as we were out of the weeds, with Kaz hanging over the bow and me knee to knee with Lasho. It was a small boat. The oarlocks were wrapped in cloth to muffle the sound. Axle grease was smeared where the locks fit into the wood.
Nice bateau, I said. You usually use it at night? Yes, but today was a special day.
Lasho rowed on, watching the riverbank as we ventured out into the water. Deep creases lined his forehead and bags hung under his wary eyes. The hands on the oars were rough and calloused, his fingernails caked with dirt.
It'd be a lot less special if the Germans catch us midstream, I said, craning my neck and listening for the sound of approaching engines. If they come now, Lasho said, straining at the oars as he gritted his teeth, then we die.
He gave a small shrug, as if it would be regrettable, but what can you expect? He had the manner of a man at ease with the thought of death. Moments before, he had been jubilant, with a frantic glint in his eyes, arranging the dead Germans just so. Now, the life had drained from his face, leaving nothing but sweat and strain as he heaved at the oars, finally breaching a thicket of reeds and drifting into the marsh, pulling in the oars and ordering us over the side.
No oars, Lasho said. If the Germans see broken reeds, they know a boat came across the river. Push!
Knee-deep in muck, we drove the small boat stern first deeper into the thicket of stalks, tying it to a fallen tree that served as decent camouflage. Then we hoofed it to dry land, the rowboat invisible from the shore or the river.
Now I eat, Lasho said, sitting on the lush green grass that grew along the riverbank. Then we go.
Where? I asked.
Saison, where you wish to go. It is not far, but it is very steep, and there are Germans. So eat.
He opened the can of diced eggs and ham and dug in, dirty fingers and all. Kaz and I did the same, using the remaining crackers to scrape out the congealed breakfast. After what we'd been through, it tasted pretty good.
Lasho seemed to like it, but who knew when he'd last had a meal?
Anton Lasho, Kaz said, rolling the name around as he spoke it. You are not French, are you? Then what am I?
Gypsy, I guessed.
He had the dark hair and looks of the few I'd encountered back home, and I remembered a lot of their names ended in the same letter.
I am Sinti, he said. Gypsy is what you Gadja call us.
Romani, Kaz explained, downing the last of his cold eggs.
The Sinti are one of the major groups that emigrated to Europe centuries ago. We are Gadja, anyone who is not Romani.
Are there other Sinti nearby? I asked Lasho, who avoided my eyes.
Now we go, he said,
taking the ration cans and burying them under a rock. It was clear he wasn't going to tell us anything, and that he knew how to get us where we needed to be.
"Are you with the resistance?" I asked, hustling to catch up with him as he stopped at a line of trees by a farmer's field. It was a simple question, but Lasho focused on the open space before us instead, lifting his face to smell the air, searching out the smell of German sweat, cigarettes, and leather.
"You must save your breath," he finally said, pointing to the far side of the field.
A steep forest faced us, wind gusting through the pines, their boughs waves of undulating green. He took off at a run on the hard-packed path along the line of trees dividing the fields, leaving no footprints.
We followed, into the woods, and from there up, bounding over logs and boulders, ducking dead branches, and trying to keep up with the silent Sinti.
It had been good advice. I needed every breath and gasp of air I had to stay with Lasho. After an hour of hard climbing, we left the thickly wooded slope and came to a meadow, flat and soft, covered with thick green growth. It looked familiar, like a lot of Lysander's landing spots in occupied France probably did. Isolated, with plentiful grass, where sheep might have grazed until the Germans had come along and confiscated everything with four legs. It had even terrain, wide enough for the small aircraft to set down, make a turn and take off again.
"Saison?"
Kaz asked, his hands on his knees as he caught his breath. Lasho held up his hand as he scanned the field and the tree line beyond. He trotted around the perimeter, swiveling his head as he searched the undergrowth. About two-thirds of the way around, he halted, sniffing the air, his nose held high like a dog searching out a scent. He knelt, his hand combing through the long grass. He came up with a cigarette butt, crushed indifferently into the ground. The word Privat was visible on the paper. It was a cheap brand issued to German soldiers. Somebody had been watching the place. Maybe a Kraut. Maybe a guy who'd taken the smokes from a Kraut he'd killed. Hard to know, but one thing was clear. He'd waited a long time. Long enough to get bored and risk lighting up. Lasho said,
"This is where the English land.
Now you are here."
"But too late. And we're not the only ones who have been here," I said.
"Can you take us to the resistance?"
"No," Lasho said. "But I will take you to the Abbey. It is safer."
"Thanks for your concern. But I think we'll be safe enough with the resistance," I said.
"You?"
"Yes."
"Me?" "No." "So we go to the Abbey. The black robes will help you. Come."
He strode across the field, not bothering to see if we followed.
We did.
"So Lasho doesn't like the Germans or the resistance," I said to Kaz, keeping my voice low as we trailed behind him.
"Not exactly, Billy. He hates the Germans, but wishes to avoid the resistance. Some sort of personal dispute, perhaps.
He said he wouldn't be safe. Not that he had a beef with some Frenchman," I said.
"Something's wrong with him. Maybe he's off his rocker."
"Perhaps the locals do not like the Sinti. It could be as simple as that," Kaz said, his half-hearted tone telling me he didn't believe it either.
"I don't think Anton Lasho is a man given to simple solutions," I said.
"Even if the folks around here didn't like the gypsies before the war, the resistance wouldn't mind one who could pull off the kind of ambush he did. There's something he's not telling us, and we've got enough problems without adding his to the mix."
"So far, Lasho has been our only source of assistance,"
Kaz said, holding back a branch as we threaded our way through the thicket. Far as I was concerned, if our only ace in the hole was Lasho, our mission was FUBAR, which was GI slang for something that was worse than snafu. Situation normal, all fucked up. FUBAR, that meant fucked up beyond all recognition, which pretty much fit. We came to a trail that switched back down the hillside. Lasho crouched and waited, listening for the sound of boots. The air was filled with chirping birds and the soft rustling of green leaves, but no clomping feet. He signaled us to follow, and we crossed the trail, bushwhacking our way down, avoiding the obvious and easy route. I had to admit, Lasho exhibited a healthy sense of self-preservation. Crazy like a fox, maybe. He stopped at a rock outcropping above the curving trail and waited for us.
La Grie, he said.
Below us, a long lake glistened in the sunlight, nestled between two hills. Afternoon shadows were already beginning to reach into the valley, and I felt the chill of night even as the sun was on my face.
The Abbey? I asked.
Lasho didn't deign to answer.
We followed. Situation normal.
An hour later, the Abbey came into view, on a hunk of land that jutted out into the lake. From our perch, we could see gray slate roofs, granite walls, a courtyard, a steeple, and cultivated fields outside the main building. Little figures in black scurried across the landscape, tending crops and doing whatever monks did to fill their time between prayers. We filtered down through the forest, Lasho even more alert as we neared the Abbey. We came close enough to make out the monks' faces as they worked their hoes in the garden beds. Lasho settled in behind the trunk of a massive tree, the rifle cradled in his lap and his eyes on the Abbey walls.
What now? I whispered.
Wait, Lasho said.
For?
A light. See the windows on the top, to the left?
He pointed to a row of narrow windows on the third floor.
Stained glass. One is very red, one is bright blue. When the sun sets, we wait for a candle. If it lights the blue window, we go inside. If it lights the red window, we run back up the mountain.
What if there is no candle? Kaz asked.
Run faster.
Chapter 5. We waited. My shoes and socks were still damp from the river, and the cold was beginning to creep up my bones. I shivered as Kaz shared the last of the food, dried fruit bars wrapped in cellophane. Lasho shot a dark glance my way as I fumbled with the wrapper, the crinkling sound not much to his liking. He produced a pocket knife, neatly slid open his package, removed the fruit bar and stowed the wrapper in Kaz's bag. Silently. We waited some more. The monks gathered their tools and went into the Abbey. The sun set. Lasho turned his head twice, listening to distant sounds. Once we heard an engine, far away, fading as it drove off in another direction. A dirt lane led to the Abbey, winding along the shore of the lake, faintly visible in the moonlight. I kept my eyes on the road while Lasho watched the windows. No one except the Germans or the resistance would be out after curfew, which began at sunset. We didn't want either of them for company. The last light disappeared at the horizon and the stars began to twinkle. I wondered how long before candles would be lit, if at all, and where we'd be right now if everything had gone according to plan. Across the border, sipping hot chocolate in front of a fire? But that was a wasted thought. Nothing goes according to plan. Our pilot knew that. The Krauts, who had been barreling down the road, masters of their peace of France a few short hours ago, knew it as well. If the dead realized anything. Soft lights began to flicker at a few windows. I watched as a glow made its way room by room, closing in on the top floor. It settled in at the blue window, the stained glass the color of the sky. Lasho rose, his dark face streaked with ghostly moonlight. The grimness and strength he'd carried all day had vanished, his gaze hesitant and his mouth slack-jawed. He stumbled off, looking more like a tired old man than a stalking killer. I felt the way he looked, but then I'd felt that way since I woke up in that shepherd's shack. We worked our way around the Abbey walls to the rear, until the lake lapped against the shore only yards away, the gray granite looming over us. Lasho picked his way through a jumble of rocks that hid a well-trodden path to a small wooden door. The wood was shiny and worn, held by iron hinges that looked centuries old. No latch, only a knotted piece of rope that hung from above. No access from the outside, no noisy knocker to attract attention. tailor-made for those on the run and seeking sanctuary. Lasho pulled on the rope twice, deliberately. Soon the door swung open, the ancient ironwork smooth and quiet. A hooded, dark form emerged and took Lasho's rifle, then pulled him inside. Others reached out for me and Kaz, and before we could blink, we were inside. The door closed and locked behind us, as we were disarmed, searched, and pushed down a dimly lit corridor by more men in dark cowls. Two of them escorted Lasho down one corridor, while three others moved Kaz and me down a set of ill-lit stairs to the musty basement, reminding me of dank prison cells, and how this whole mission was definitely not going according to plan. Things looked up as we were brought into a well-lit warm kitchen. A large cast-iron stove took up one wall, with a square table and chairs of plain rough wood at the center. The hooded men were quickly revealed to be monks in black robes, as Lasho had described. Chairs were held out for us, and soup ladled from a pot simmering on the stove. Wine was poured from an earthen jug, and when they were done serving, the monk stepped back, one of them leaving the room. Kaz spoke in rapid-fire French. I didn't understand much, basically because I was too busy slurping soup to pay attention. The monk stood in silence, no response offered. No wonder Lasho liked it here.
I think they are Benedictines, Kaz said, as he tasted the wine.
One eyebrow went up, which I took to mean he was pleasantly surprised.
The black cloaks and the silence.
How are we going to communicate then? I asked. Sign language? I took a gulp of wine.
Not bad. Not that I'd know good. Benedictines practice periods of silence, but they are not a silent order, and they are released from silence when necessary.
Where do you think they took Lasho? I said. Why separate us?
They obviously know him, if that means anything,
Kaz said, blowing on a spoonful of soup.
They took his weapons immediately and brooked no argument from him.
Ours too, for that matter. But I can understand monks not wanting armed men wandering the abbey. The door opened and the two monks moved to make room, giving a slight bow as they stood aside. The fellow who entered wore the same black getup, but he was obviously high up in the holy pecking order. He tossed back his cowl and smiled pleasantly.
Welcome, gentlemen, he said. You are the answer to our prayers.
He spoke in a clipped, precise manner, his French accent barely discernible.
Thank you, Father, I said, getting to my feet, not sure what you called a monk. Nuns were sisters, so were they brothers? I should have paid better attention to parochial school back in Boston.
I have to wonder what you've been praying for. My name is Billy Boyle, and this is...
No names, please,
he said, waving his hand apologetically.
It is better for all concerned. Please, sit and eat.
He pulled up a chair next to Kaz and took his time studying our faces. His was well-lined, peaceful and calm.
Stands to reason. It was a pretty peaceful life here by a beautiful lake, with crops in the field and jugs of wine at hand. Except for guys like Lasho dropping by, that is.
A wise precaution, Kaz said. If names are not known, they cannot be spoken.
Exactly, our host said. Even an alias, if the Germans hear it repeatedly, can cost lives.
I thought you were in the business of saving souls, not lives, Father. I figured since he hadn't corrected me, that title would do.
We are shut away from the world, my son, but we are still of the world. We do what we can to ease suffering, something that should not be as dangerous as it is today. But that is the world God has given us, so what else can we do?
Well, you've eased our hunger, and for that we're grateful, I said, raising my glass in his direction. He smiled and bowed his head in acknowledgement. But you may not want us here for much longer.
Are the Germans searching for you?
He asked. Our aircraft crash-landed some distance from here. They may have given up the chase for us by now, but our friend may have stirred up a hornet's nest.
Hornets?
He asked, taking a second to figure out what I'd meant.
Oh, yes, Le Frelon. And there's no need to avoid his name. Everyone knows Anton Lasho, especially the Germans.
Why? I asked.
That is a long and sad story, and it has to do with what we've been praying for. But first, please, eat and drink. Then the brothers will take your garments to be washed and show you to your quarters. Soon, I will explain everything.
Thank you, Kaz said. It will be a relief to have these muddy clothes clean again.
Of course, he said. You will have to look your best in Switzerland, won't you?
With that, he departed, leaving us to wonder how he knew about Switzerland. We'd mentioned it to Lasho when we tried to get a fix on a location, but we hadn't said it was our destination. Bread, soup, and wine distracted me from any further thoughts on the matter. When we were done, our monk escorts brought us to a small room upstairs, lit by a single candle. There were two beds, a few chairs, and a small table with a jug of water and wooden cups. The monks took all of our clothes and shoes in exchange for a couple of woolen nightgowns. Itchy woolen nightgowns, but I told myself not to complain.
What do you think the good father has in mind? Kaz asked as he sat on the straw mattress. He seems the decent type.
That's what worries me, I said. The decent types are ones who want you to risk your neck to do the decent thing. As they see it, anyway.
You are too young to be such a cynic, Billy.
Hey, I'm still alive. Made it to the quarter century mark, so I must be doing something right.
Pure luck, Kaz said, smiling as he stretched out on the bed.
Let's hope that luck holds, and the father will know how to contact the Jedburgh team, or at least the local resistance.
Knuckles rapped on the door, and speak of the devil, if that isn't too sacrilegious, the black-robed monk himself stepped into the room. He took a seat and gestured for us to do the same. I felt a bit ridiculous in my nightgown, but maybe that was the idea. Sure, he was basically wearing the same sort of thing, but on him it looked good.
Father, I don't know how involved you are with the resistance, but I have to ask if you've seen any allied soldiers in the area.
You mean the Jedburghs, he said, the Frenchmen. The Englishman and the American.
Yes. Can you put us in touch with them?
They are dead, I am sorry to say, as well as a good number of Marquis.
The resistance fighters who lived in the hills.
Yours was to be the last Lysander landing at that location. It was too well known and had become dangerous. Father, how do you know so much about our mission?
There is no reason for me to tell you exactly how I know. Suffice it to say, I am in communication with those who do know.
He meant a radio. He also meant that if we were captured, we'd talk. Sooner or later, with the right application of pain. Smart guy.
I am aware the Jedburghs were to guide you to the Swiss border and make contact with someone who could get you across. But all that has changed. They were caught up in an anti-Protestant sweep and killed. Luckily for them, since it was quick, at least in relation to what their Germans would have done. God bless their souls.
I'm sorry to hear that, I said, but do you have a way to get us to that contact?
It would be difficult, but not impossible, he said. It is a journey of 80 kilometers. I have sent a courier to ask the resistance chief to provide a guide for you.
They will take us, surely? Kaz said.
It is not so simple,
the monk said, as if struggling with how to deliver the bad news. I tried to figure the angles, to understand what he wanted, to put together the bits and pieces of what I knew about the situation. Lasho hated the Germans and had a problem with the resistance. The Jedburghs and the Marquis had gotten caught up in a sweep. Who were the Germans hunting in their sweep? Lasho was a killer. No more Lysander flights were scheduled for Sasan because it was too dangerous. Why?
Because Anton Lasho was running amok, killing every German he could find, not caring about the consequences, life or death. The father cared about all three. Presto, the answer presented itself.
You want us to take Lasho with us, all the way to Switzerland?
Yes, he said, and the resistance will not help. They will likely kill him if they find him. They have their own rules. Harsh rules, but sensible.
Like no indiscriminate killing, I said.
To a degree, yes. An attack has to be worthwhile. in terms of reprisals. Anton does not follow any such rule.
Why? I asked. And why do you care so much about him?
I care for his soul, but I also care for his sanity. Anton has suffered greatly, and I fear their burden may break him.
He rubbed his eyes. There is terrible suffering all around us, I said. What's so special about Anton's?
I knew there had to be guilt at work in this monk's desire to help Lasho. It's a great motivator, especially for a decent guy. We helped Anton some time ago. He and his family. You must understand, we can only do so much for refugees. The Germans search the abbey often. We can do little but provide food and shelter for one night and send people on to the Swiss border.
Plus, you have a radio, and you can't risk that being discovered, I said.
If the Germans find anything here, we face certain death. Then we could help no one, he said, his voice quivering in anger at my insinuation, at the intolerable truth of it.
His glistening eyes looked beyond us, searching for forgiveness, or perhaps simply dreaming of a simpler time.
A radio, a single refugee, an escaped prisoner, or a rifle. It does not matter to the Germans.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.